remember sitting in an office in the church where I was director, and I had an album of Simon and Garfunkel songs, and there was one on there that I really appreciated and liked, and I've liked it ever since, and I'm talking about 1964, 65, and it was called Last Night I Had the Strangest Dream. How many have heard that song? Oh, quite a few. Well, I'd like to sing it. And I've asked Pete if he would play the banjo for me. And we'll see how it sounds. Last night I had the strangest dream I never dreamed before. I dreamed the world had all agreed to put an end to war. I dreamed I saw a mighty room, and the room was filled with men. And the papers they were signing read, "We'll never fight again." And when the papers were all signed and a million copies made, they all joined hands and bowed their heads, and prayerful prayers were prayed. And the people in the streets below were dancing round and round, and swords and guns and uniforms were scattered all on the ground. Last night I had the strangest dream I ever dreamed before. I dreamed that all the world agreed to put an end to Peter, if he would take a few moments, maybe reflect on his thoughts about Dr. King and anything else he would like to do at this occasion.
I met Martin Luther King twice, very briefly. The first time was only about a year after the bus boycott, in the year of August 1957. He and Reverend Abernathy and Rosa Parks drove about 100 miles up from Montgomery to a very small school called the Highlander Folk School. It was a very interesting place. There's no other school quite like it in America. It was started by a man who'd been born in the mountains of Tennessee, where there were nothing but one-room schoolhouses. His parents found they had a very bright kid, and they said, "You know, if we moved down and got a job in a textile factory, our kid could go to the local school and maybe he'd get good marks and could get like a scholarship to a college." That's what they did. And sure enough, 15 years later, he did. 12 years later, he got a scholarship to a college up north. And when they asked him what he was going to do with his life, he said, "I want to start a school back in the mountains. They don't have decent schools back there." And they said, "Where will you get the money?" He said, "I don't know." He said, "You should go to Scandinavia, where they have what they call the folk school movement." It seems that back in the 1820s, Bishop Grootvig of Norway said, any group of people who can read and write and speak can teach themselves almost anything if they form a group. It has to be bigger than two or three people, but not so big as 10 or 15. The ideal size is 7 or 8. And this man, his name is Miles Horton, spent a year in Denmark. and came back and started what he called the Highlander Folk School in the mountains of Tennessee, about 100 miles west of Knoxville. And a retired academic professor found a farmhouse he could use. And it was to this farmhouse that a seamstress from Montgomery came to study for 2 weeks. They had a seminar there. And at the end of the seminary, Miles Horton says, "What will you do when you get home to put into practice what you've learned here?" They were studying, how is the South going to get rid of Jim Crow and segregation? And the seamstress said, when it came her turn to speak, but one woman said, "I'm going to start voter registration." And the man said, "I have to start before that. Some of my people can't read or write. I'm going to start classes in how to read." They came to this seamstress, and she said, "I don't really know what I'm going to do." She said, "You must think of something." Well, she said, "I really don't know what I'm going to do, but I am going to do something." And I guess you know, her name was Rosa Parks. She sat down. Now, here's the important thing. I feel that I learned almost the most important lessons of my life. It turned my political thinking around, my philosophical thinking around, my day-to-day action around the life and what Dr. King taught me. Who could say that riding in the front seat was the most important thing? Why didn't King tackle something really important like jobs or voting or schools? But he tackled the job of riding in the front seat of the bus. And I say, when you face an opponent over a broad front, you don't aim for your opponent's strong points. You aim for some little point way off at the side that most people might think I'm not too important, but you win it. And that's what he did. It took him 13 months, but he won it. And later on he said the most important speech he ever made in his life was the first one where they decided to have a bus boycott was on Saturday night. Rosa sat down on Friday. On Saturday night, 200 people came to his church. And they also invited newspaper reporters. So we got in the Sunday papers. Most of the white people probably laughed. "Ha-ha, the blacks think they're going to have a boycott. It'll last 2 hours. Well, Sunday night, there were 2,000 people at the church. They couldn't all get in. They had loudspeakers out in the parking lot. And there King said, "We are going to win this boycott if we are non-violent." And he repeated it. And that was the most important part of his speech. We will win if we are nonviolent. How did he do it? There was great disagreement between different people. Black lawyers or doctors they'd come to him, "Dr. King, your house has been bombed. People have been killed at the church. We should accept a compromise. We don't want more violence to happen." King said, "Come to the church tomorrow night, we'll discuss it." And there were younger people who said, "Look, they bombed us. Why don't we bomb them? Are we scared?" And he'd say, "Come to the church tomorrow night." And here were two groups of people who disagreed with each strongly. And he said, "Now you talk, and you ask questions." Maybe 20 minutes later, he said, "Now you talk and you ask questions." And the talk would go on late at night. And they said, "Well, we'll have to keep on talking tomorrow. We still don't have an agreement." Sometimes he called it a retreat, the religious term. And it would sometimes go on for a day or even 2 days. But finally, and King would not let any of them say, "I don't care what happens next." He said, "We know we are not going to win unless we can work together." And finally they say, okay, this is what we will say and this is what we will do. And they would move forward. This extraordinary talented man, you know, he graduated from the high school at only age 15. He was a genius with words. At age 14, in the local Atlanta newspaper, some white man wrote, "Why do Negroes want to marry whites? We're not meant to marry." This 14-year-old boy writes, "Dear editor, surely Mr. So-and-so," whoever wrote that letter, "must know that if there are people of mixed ancestry in America, it is not because Negroes want to marry whites, but because of aggressive white males taking advantage of defenseless black females." In one sentence, he would have said, well, everybody else would have taken a paragraph or two to say. He was an absolute genius when it came to words. And as you heard, after 4 years at Morehouse and 3 years at Divinity School, he admired two professors in Boston University and studied there. Now his own academic reputation had spread, and he was offered 3 good jobs at 3 separate northern universities. He turned down all 3 for a lower paying job in a little church in Montgomery, because he knew that that was where the job had to be done and the people who had to do the job. The job was not going to be done by Northern liberals. It was going to be done by the black and white people of the South, because there were many whites who wanted to see an end to Jim Crow, but they were scared to speak out too. I knew one of these men. He was a Jewish professor, Joe Gilder, in Birmingham. And he spoke out and worked with the NAACP, and the Ku Klux Klan grabbed him, took him out of the country, and almost killed him by a terrible beating. He did recover, and he stayed down there and kept talking. But that kind of heroism doesn't come always. And King, as you know, received death threats every week of his life. He knew that sooner or later he would be killed. There's a whole book called The Execution of Dr. King. J. Edgar Hoover thought that King was the most dangerous man in America. And he'd been trying to get the President of the United States to do something about it. However, King reached the whole country with his speeches. And Lyndon Johnson, who took office after Kennedy was assassinated, decided he would help King. And as you know, the Voting Rights Act was finally passed, and blacks could now vote in the South. And then, well, I'll tell you, the second time I met King was just a year before he was assassinated. There were 100,000 people in the United Nations Plaza, in right across from the big, high, tall United Nations skyscraper. 100,000 people were jammed in that block. You couldn't move, it was so crowded. And I sang a few songs, got them singing with me. But then I saw a black car inching its way through the crowd. It must have taken him 15 minutes for that car to get near the speaker stand. And then about 20 feet away, the door opened and out came Dr. King. Six strong men pushed the crowd aside. "Please let Dr. King through." But the crowd wanted to get close to him, and they pushed him. I said, how can any person live with this kind of fame and adoration? But finally he got up to the speaker's stand, and the speech he gave there, the same one he gave the night before in Riverside Church, I heard him say, "I have to face the fact that my country is the greatest purveyor of violence in the world. We must get out of Vietnam." Well, I have no proof of it, but I bet down in the White House, Lyndon Johnson was absolutely furious. He was probably throwing things around. "After all I did for him, after all I did for him, look what he does to me. Look what he does to me now." And that's when he probably called up J. Edgar Hoover, who'd been wanting to get rid of King for years. Probably said, "Do what you want." King knew the mafia in New Orleans. J. Edgar Hoover knew the mafia in New Orleans. This is according to the book by the lawyer for James Earl Ray. James Earl Ray was in jail for shooting a bullet which came into the neck of Martin Luther King. But the lawyer brought the King family to meet James Earl Ray, and they agreed that he didn't actually fire the shot. He was a patsy, as they say. The mafia in New Orleans had told J. Edgar Hoover, "Let us know when you want the job done. We know how to do it." That's all I know. That's all the lawyer knows. You might be interested to know that J. Edgar Hoover was appointed to be head of the FBI when he was in his 20s, way back in the early 1920s. He served as head for 60 years and died in office. How did that happen? Republicans, Democrats, whoever, no one touched J. Edgar Hoover. I'll tell you one more story. There was a liberal Catholic governor in Michigan who was appointed by Franklin Roosevelt to be Attorney General for the United States. And when he packed up his office, closed up his office in Michigan, he said to his secretary, "You know, the first thing I'll do when I get to Washington is fire J. Edgar Hoover." But 6 months later, he was back in Michigan, and his former secretary says, "Well, Governor Murphy, how come Hoover is still on the job?" Murphy said, "Oh, you don't understand. That man has something on everybody." He had his agents investigate every senator and every representative, every judge, every diplomat, every high official, including Roosevelt himself, who had a mistress down in Georgia since the First World War. Mrs. Roosevelt discovered his love letters and said, "Franklin, this is the end of our marriage. On the other hand, you have a great future in politics, and I would like to help you. I will not divorce you, but this is the end of us as man and wife." What an extraordinary woman she was. When Roosevelt finally died, Eleanor Roosevelt wrote a letter to the woman in Georgia, said, "I am grateful to you, and I think the country should be. You were able to give my husband his long life, but I was unable to give him." Not many women would be able to be that generous. Well, all I can say is the king and what he did, I hope, will be learned by the entire world, because we have huge problems, and we have an old tradition of killing. You know, all our ancestors were good killers for hundreds of thousands, millions of years. Yes, one tribe here, a little tribal community, they were tribal communists. They shared everything they had. But right next, a few miles away, was another little village and another little tribe. But one becomes more successful, and they grow, and they invade the hunting ground of their neighbor, and now it is a war to the death. The ones who were not good killers didn't have descendants. All our ancestors were good killers. In the human race, a woman was born with a big brain in East Africa about 100,000 years ago, and her daughters had big brains. And about 60,000 years later, a man was born with a big brain, and his sons had big brains. 10,000 years later, these sons and daughters had gotten together, and they all were born with big brains. They took over Africa in 10,000 years. 50,000 years ago, some went around the shores of the Indian Ocean, and the Australian Aborigines have only been there 50,000 years, 40,000 years about. Others went east, and the ones who went north of the Himalayas, the Koreans are descended from them. The Japanese are descended from the ones that went south of the Himalayas. 35 to 40,000 years, they disagree exactly. All this is because of the carbon-14 dating process. You dig up carbon, whether it's in the bones of somebody who died or oyster shells. Oh, down in Bannerman's Island, an Italian-American amateur dug through 6 feet of oyster shells and found oyster shells 3,000 years old. That's at least how long Native Americans were living here, 3,000 years ago. Oh, I think 4,000 years ago on Denning's Point, they found record. But it's an old tradition to want to kill one's enemies. We started walking on 2 feet 2 or 3 million years ago and picked up a stick, whack. So ever since then, people have liked to go whack. I like to chop wood. I'm halfway healthy now at age 90, because I get a little exercise every day splitting wood. But that's why golf and baseball and tennis, you go whack, makes you feel good. Somehow, you and I have to find ways we can carry on what Dr. King taught us. Think globally, act locally. Let's find ways in which these seats can be full every Sunday. And maybe the rectory will be full every day, night of the week, as different parts of the city of Beacon say, no, we need a place to meet. Oh, you'll give us a place to meet? Wonderful. You don't mind the fact that we have a different religion? The ecumenical spirit is spreading. You've seen it spread in Beacon. It's going to spread throughout the country. It's going to spread around the world. We can talk with people we disagree with. I've taken far more time than I should. I was told to take 15 minutes, and I forgot to bring a clock with me, so I'm sure I've spoken for 20 minutes now. But it was requested that I sing We Shall Overcome. I'll give you the chords, and I think you can sing. Nobody knows who wrote this song. There's a gospel song usually sung quite fast. I'll overcome. But the original verse was, I'll be all right someday, if in my heart I do believe, I'll be all right someday. And over 100 years ago, they made up union verses, and another verse is, I'll wear a crown. I'll be like him. And the verse, I'll overcome. And that fourth verse was picked up by unions. We will overcome. And that was sung way back over 100 years ago. But in 1946, 300 tobacco workers were on strike in Charleston, South Carolina, and one of the women there liked to sing this song very, very, very slowly. They'd see her coming, oh, here comes Lucille. Now we'll hear that song sung slower than anybody ever sung it. And, now, if you don't sing, this won't be much of a song. Who can they get the high up? Let me hear you hum. Now open your mouth. Now, if there's somebody who can sing bass, I'd like to hear some bass singers. And if there's any high tenors or soprano, and don't think you have to sing the same part. It goes so slowly that you have time to slide over and get a better note if you think you have the wrong note. Thank you.
Shout, when do we want it?
And then everybody shout, now.
Let's sing that last verse. We shall
overcome. We shall overcome. We shall overcome someday.
Oh, Jesus.